the way in which security is useful, and it's not just climate change, I think, that's securitized in the United States, but a whole range of complex issues that touch on the broad political spectrum. The way in which security is useful is it tries to remove the issue from normal politics, where you would have contestation, debate, deliberation, a lengthy sort of process of coming to agreement. And security says, no, there's an urgent threat that we're facing now, so we have no time for political debate and contestation. The authority to resolve the issue needs to be centralized. It needs to be removed from normal politics, and then we execute a swift security response. And so particularly in the lead up to the Copenhagen negotiations in 2009, you really saw this from the Obama administration, and it's explored in the book and also in other articles that I've written, but you see kind of the use of security language. Climate change isn't an economic opportunity, it's not a matter of moral dilemma, it's not an issue of aid, it's a national security threat. And if we don't act on climate change, there will be severe outcomes for humanity, for the things that we value, for human civilization. So this very severe language. And that, I think, was a real effort by the Obama administration to try to consolidate authority, to create this, okay, it's a danger, it's a threat, therefore we need to let a centralized actor, we need to let the presidential administration resolve this problem. And with climate change, it's very difficult because, you know, for one thing, it's a long-term problem. You think about climatic changes, not in one season, but over the course of decades or even centuries. It's not localized. So we see changing weather patterns, stochastic weather, on a daily basis, but understanding what climate means in a local context is very difficult because it's not something, so there's not really a felt impact. And for example, 2 years ago, there were 9 feet of snow in Boston. So people who think climate change is about global warming would say, no, wait a second, that's not climate change because we just had horrible snow in Boston. So that disconnect between the urgency of the issue, the immediacy and directness of a concrete response that you see in security language doesn't really operate in climate change. So the public didn't accept it. And I think it also, in terms of framing, it's effective to the extent to which it generates a centralized solution. It generates this urgency and need to resolve the problem, but it's not terribly effective because if you think about what's required to resolve climate change, large-scale collaborative interaction amongst polities, amongst industry, amongst policymakers, across civil society, security language doesn't generate that kind of response. It's all about threat, about the creation of different groups. Us versus them or the external enemy. There has to be something to combat. And so that doesn't necessarily work for a solution to climate change. What I would recommend if the next president does believe in climate change and does seek a solution or seek to be part of the solution would be a wide-scale survey of American values. So understanding which values are operating in different communities or maybe even across different political constituencies. And then attaching the policy response to the language of those values. So for some regions, that might be, responding to issues of drought, responding to issues of flooding in other places, thinking about, even economic or social impacts as the climate changes, and making the policy, it's not necessarily centralizing the policy around those issues, but highlighting the policy through those issues. What does climate change, or however we reframe and rephrase it, what does it mean for local economic impacts, local social impacts? And so I think that's really important. And then there's also, this issue of the temporal frame. People, this is a sort of widespread or wide-held psychological as well as behavioral economic belief that people discount the future, right? And this is one of the challenges. People are particularly adverse to taking personal sacrifices now for private sacrifices now, for long-term collective gains. And so the extent to which I think the solution can be made personal and the policy responses can be made practical, I think that really will have an impact in creating consensus around the issue in the United States.